I would like to present block 3, that is William Wordsworth and his famous composition Preface to Lyrical Ballads. So guys, who are romantic writers? Those are the people who write Valentine's Day cards, right? Well, not exactly. While most people associate the word romantic with love, in a literary context, it is much different from others' perspective. Romanticism is a thoroughly controversial term, and to define it is as hopeless a task as ever. F.L. Lucas, in The Decline and Fall of the Romantic Ideal in 1948, counted as many as 11,396 definitions of romanticism, and none of them is completely off the target. A few of the most important definitions may be glanced at here. For example, according to Theodore Watts Dunton, the Romantic Revival was equivalent to the Renaissance of Wonder. Renaissance of Wonder is a state of being where individuals are more concerned with what can be as opposed to what is. So Renaissance of Wonder become a part of its transformative quality. And Renaissance of Wonder is found in love of nature. To discover this and to find it in one's experience of self is where the Renaissance of Wonder exists. According to Walter Peter, romanticism means the addition of strangeness to beauty, whereas classicism is order to beauty. So in the words of Walter Peter, because curiosity and love of beauty are the main relevant of romantic ideology, thus the integral parts of the romantic attitude are there. Herford points out that the romantic movement was primarily an extraordinary development of imaginative sensibility. So there is an imagination as the supreme poetic quality regarded in romantic movement. It is superior to reason. Inspired by the ideals of the French Revolution to shake up the foundations of old hierarchical structures and distressed by the rise of the choking city life, the romantic Wordsworth set out to challenge old notions regarding poetry. So romanticism, that also the romantic era or the romantic period, was an artistic, literary and intellectual movement that originated in Europe towards the end of the 18th century. Next. So it was a revolt against the aristocratic social and political norms of the Age of Enlightenment and a reaction against the scientific rationalization of nature. It was embodied most strongly in the visual arts, music and literature, but had a major impact on historiography, education and the natural sciences. So what kind of revolt? It is a revolt against the scientific rationalization and instead emotion. So revolt against industrial revolution is as example in Blake's poem Chimney Sweeper, where we see that child worker worked hard in industries. Romanticism aimed as a return to nature that would bring out the goodness of humanity, the development of nationalistic pride and the exaltation of the senses of emotions over reason and intellect combined to make romanticism was a philosophical revolt against rationalism. The age of romanticism begins in England from the publication of Wordsworth and Coleridge's Lyrical Ballad, 1798. So in the preface to its second edition, that is in year 1800, Wordsworth stated his two cardinal beliefs. First, the poetry results from the spontaneous overflow of powerful feelings. And second, the relevance of the use of natural everyday diction in literary works. Next. As a romanticist, Coleridge upheld the importance of the poetic imagination and rejected neoclassical literary rules. Poetry does not require a special language. It is a matter of communication. So neoclassical language was vague and unfeeling. The other English romantic poets like Byron, Shelley, Robert Burns, Keats, Robert Southey, and William Cowper celebrated the individual self. The emphasis is repeated in the prose works of Charles Lamb and William Hazlitt and in Thomas De Quincey's autobiographical Confessions of an English Opium Eater in 1822. Although the romantic period is set to begin in 1798, the year of the first edition of Lyrical Ballads by Wordsworth and Coleridge and of the composition of Hymns to the Night by Knollys and ending in 1832. It begins in the 1770s and continues into the second half of the 19th century. So apart from the two major differences, the rejection of reason and the celebration of the imagination, Romanticism replaced the understanding of art as a mimetic form to an expressive form. So what is said here is clear that Romanticism felt that rationalism was taking man away from nature. For example, a romantic might have said that a myth is more true than historical fact, because myth provide insight into what people thought and felt and were not just recordings of what some said happened. Also, the new classical insistence on the idea that art reflects the general or universal characteristics of human behavior was rejected in preference of individuality and particularity in themes. The Romantics fully believed in the supreme importance of the individual and uniqueness. Romanticism create new literary types like the rebel and adventurers. The style of writing of the Romantics discarded the preceding age's practice of restraint and opted for suggestiveness. The neoclassical ideal of clarity, free experimentation over the rules of composition, genre, and decorum were seen to be inadequate in expressing the artist as creator. Unlike neoclassical criticism, Romantic criticism did not seek moral lesson in literature. It judges a literary work by its capacity to please always and please all. So we can say that the Romantic writers does not see things in the light of common day, but adds to them the lights that never was on land and sea. But the most convincing definition of Romanticism is one poet is romantic because he falls in love, another romantic because he sees a ghost, another romantic because he is reconciled to the church. So it has its roots in the Reformity, French Revolution, which stood for liberty, equality, and fraternity. That was the motto of French Revolution, which was culminated in 1798 in France. Next heading is publication of preface of Lyrical Ballads. Lyrical Ballads was planned with Coleridge in 1797 when Wordsworth was living at Rasedown with his sister Dorothy. The volume appeared the following year with four poems by Samuel Taylor Coleridge, including The Ancient Mariner and 19 by William Wordsworth. So there were 23 poems in Lyrical Ballads and one preface. It is not that Lyrical Ballads was Wordsworth's first publication. He has started publishing poetry from 1793 onwards. The preface to Lyrical Ballads is an essay composed by William Wordsworth for the second edition that is published in January 1801 and often referred to as the 1800 edition. Attack on neoclassical poetry. During the new classical age, the poets were considered to be extraordinary persons. New classical poetry saw human nature as dualistic and wanted to curb by human reason to any of the mind. Their clothes were complicated and detailed, and their garden ornately manicured and geometrical designed. They always dealt with the aristocrats and the decorated drawing rooms, fashionable, courtly, balls, masquerades, its. The poets of the neoclassical age believed in writing poetry that head-to-head dominate over heart. They used the language of the aristocrats. As a result, the common people could not approach their poems. The poetic diction and the use of verse or the rhyme scheme were also inscrutable to the average readers. Before Wordsworth, the people looked upon the poets as bats or creator or something extraordinary. But Wordsworth declares that a poet is a man who talks with men. He says that the language of poetry must be that of prose. That is why his famous composition, The Prelude, was in blank verse. And blank verse is without meter. It is a kind of prose. So most of his large poem is seen as prose. He opposes to use figurative language or decorative language. He does not want a thinking of neoclassical poetry, because in neoclassical poetry, there were lack of representativeness, lack of nature. Their poetry is highly decorative, and in there is lot of Latinism used in their poetry. Before Wordsworth, the poets of the neoclassical age were always devoted to bombastic words, phrases, and figurative language. Wordsworth does not like to instruct true poetry. He aims at giving delight, not to didact the reader. So he has a prophetic vision. He wants to give his reader a prophetic vision to read poetry. He further says that poetry does not need much labor. It is a spontaneous overflow. It will come out of lips without much labor. There is no need of hard work to produce poetry. Next. He says, preface to the lyrical ballad and its introduction. In Wordsworth's opinion, the language of poetry must not be separated from the language of men in real life. Figures, metaphors, and similes and other such decorations must not be used unnecessarily, as was the case with the artificial 18th century poetic diction. Neoclassical poetry were the products of imagination. Hence, the neoclassical critic believed that imagination is a combination of power, not a creative one. On the other, romantic critics, according to romantic critics, it is highly creative faculty. So the main tenets of the Wordsworth theory is given below. The language of poetry should be the language really used by men, especially by simple rustic people who live close to nature. So what we mean rustic? Rustic is a typical of the country people or simple, no polishing, and they distinguished from town and cities. So simple rustic people who live close to nature, but it should be a selection of such language. All the words used by the people cannot be employed in poetry. Only selected and chosen words used in common preference can serve the purpose of poetry. It should be the language of men in a state of vivid sensation. It means that language used by people in state of animation can form the language of poetry. In other words, it should be a lively language expressing living emotions of real life like men. Third, it should have a certain coloring of the imagination. Fourth, there is no essential difference between the words used in prose and in a metrical composition, because Wordsworth does not want that poetry should be in a constructed manner, in a hard manner. He wanted that every expression should be natural. Tired of the highly elevated topics of neoclassical poets and their overcomplicated language, Wordsworth found inspiration from everyday figures of everyday life. In Prelude, he showed us many episodes. First, boat stealing, basking, kite flying, and every sports and games of ordinary life. He wanted to give us message that his events were on example of everyday life. Whether it be the famous solitary reaper or the daffodils, Wordsworth's poetry flows to admire the simple beauty that exists in daily life. He then opens that poetry is the pursuit of truth, of man's knowledge about himself and the world surrounding him, whereas science pursues material truths and remains, as the pleasure of a select few poetry, in his opinion, cleave to us a necessary part of our existence. In these lines, he pointed out that poetry should guide a kind of truth which should be prophetic, which should be the do the working of enlightenment. So poetry is also seen as the breed and final spirit of knowledge and as the impassioned expression which is in the countenance of all science, and thus it is great source for good. He added the preface. Now we move on the purpose. He added the preface because he felt that his poems were different in theme and style. Therefore, he should not present them without an introduction. It is well observed phenomenon that every new poet struggles to carve a niche. That is what Wordsworth tried to do with the help of the preface. The primary object which Wordsworth proposed to propagate through the poems was to select incidents and situations from common life. His purpose to show the reader every simple aspect of life that is related to individual like farmer and workers. The great innovation was to be in the language. The poetic diction of the 18th century sought to substitute the selection of the language really used by men. The advertisement included in the 1798 edition shows Wordsworth's concern about the language of poetry. Wordsworth says that the poems in the volume are experiments, since his chief aim is to see if the conversational language in use among the middle and lower classes of society can be employed expediently and fruitfully to write poems. So poetry should have a worthy purpose. And because another lack in the 18th century poetry, according to Wordsworth, was that it was often trivial, and poets brought a meanness into it. There was a meanness of thought as well as language in the poetry of some of his contemporaries. He did not mean to be deliberately and consciously didactic. The true poet is able to connect thoughts and feelings. So neoclassical poetry dealt with the upper section of society. The rustic and country folk were treated as targets of ridicule and within their poetry. Falstaff feeling, Wordsworth made shepherds' cottages and dressed people the heroes of his poem. On the other hand, one of the example from Rape of the Lock by Alexander Pope, where he said once that Belinda smiles and all the world becomes gay. So it shows that their language was highly ornated, highly decorative, and suitable for courtly life. There had been no need to be witty in a dry and intellectual manner. So 18th century poetry was often trivial, and there was a meanness of thought, because he felt that the purpose of the poetry is that of it enlightening and purifying the mind of the reader. The true poet is able to connect thoughts and feelings. He comes to have a habit of contemplation, which makes him discover universal truths of human nature. The poet then writes automatically of such subjects and expresses such feelings which are noble and worthy. Wordsworth would try to be such a poet as against the contemporary poet who dealt with trivialities. Next section is definition of poetry. So poetry is the spontaneous overflow of powerful feeling. It takes its origin from emotion recollected in tranquility. William Wordsworth says that poetry is flow of emotion, feelings. He says that poems which any value can be attached were never produced on any variety of subjects, but by a man who, being possessed of more than organic sensibility, had also thought long and deeply. Our feelings modified and directed by our thoughts. So the nature of poetry, according to him, is to involve a discussion of the subject matter of the theme, the language suitable for poetry, the function of a poet, and poetic pleasure. The insistence on spontaneity, however, should not blind us to the fact that Wordsworth does not advocate a chaotic or uncontrolled energy of emotional things. Poetry is the spontaneous overflow. That is the moral purpose of Wordsworth. The poetic process has four stages for successful composition to take place. It is not an easy process. The four stages of the process are recollection, contemplation, recrudescence or renewal of the original emotion, and composition. So thoughts are representatives for our past feelings. By solving the relation of this representative feeling, we can know what is important for men. By repetition, these things which make strong our feeling connected with subjects. If we have sensibility, habits of mind will be produced. By following this habit, we describe objects. Understanding of the reader must necessarily be in some degree enlightened, and his affections strengthened and purified. In short, we can say that poetry is an imagination of poets' thought and habits. Poetry is the instrument for the propagation of moral thoughts, like in the first composition of William Wordsworth in Daffodils. He gave the idea in that poem that flowers are not only decorative, but they feel, they have sense, they have emotions. Wordsworth's poetry does not simply delight us and brings home to us deep philosophical truths about life and religion. So poetry, it is not the result of reason, art, and objectivity, but the result of imagination, spontaneity, and individuality of the poet, where we see that the creative activity carries with it pleasure indeed. As Wordsworth calls it, in the process of poetic composition, the mind is upon the whole in a state of enjoyment. There will be a reflection of this pleasure in the poetic composition. Next. Now we move to the section Preference for Humble and Rustic Life. The poet's aim has been to choose incidents and situations from common life and to relate them in a selection of language really used by men, and at the same time to throw over them coloring of imagination, whereby ordinary things would be presented to the mind in an unusual aspect. So in poetry, no more reproduction of reality is the motto of Wordsworth. Romanticism has freedom and originality. So much so with Wordsworth. Romanticism has subjectivity, and Wordsworth also has, because Wordsworth judged a work in relation to the poet's mind and its inner working. Appreciation was often based on personal impression. According to Wordsworth, poetry should a worthy purpose for enlightenment and purifying the mind. He did not mean to be didactic manipulatively. So he has chosen the various aspects of humble and rustic life for a number of reasons. These reasons are, first, in humble and rustic life, feelings are freely and frankly expressed. B, in rustic life, feelings are more simple and so are expressed more accurately and forcefully. C, the manners of the rustics are not sophisticated. They are simple and so more conducive to an understanding of human nature. D, in rustic life, human passions are connected with the grand and noble objects of nature, and so they are more noble and permanent. Next section is choice of rustic language. He has used the language of rustics because such men hourly communicate with the best objects of nature from which the best part of language is derived, because they have a lot of time to spend in nature. During spending their time, they have objectivity to see the every aspect of nature. And because they convey their feelings and emotions in a simple, unelaborated, and more philosophical language. Every poem in the collection differs from contemporary poetry because there is nothing mean and trivial about it. Every one of his poems has a worthy purpose, that of enlightening the readers and purifying their emotions. So they are the spontaneous overflow of passion, but passion has been modified by thought. In his poems, feelings are more important than action and situation. Every kind of poem, we see that a kind of prophetic vision, a kind of mysticism in the poetry of Wordsworth. So he has tried to correct the contemporary craving for the unusual in situation and incidents. Next. Now we move most important part of preface to lyrical ballads, that is the poet. Wordsworth emphasized the social function of poetry. A poet writes not for his pleasure alone, but for the pleasure of his reader. So we have a question in our mind, what is a poet? Wordsworth's answer is, he is a man speaking to men. We are struck immediately by the fact that the poet's main function is that of communication. He is a man writing not merely for his own pleasure, but in order to share his thoughts and feelings with an audience, that is, his readers. The social implications of a poet's function is quite clear. He is an uncommon man, gifted in many ways and in some ways superior to the common folk. The poet is essentially a man speaking to men. He differs from other men not in nature, but merely in the degree of his and her. He is a man of greater sensibility, observation, reflection, and imagination, of greater powers of communication. He can therefore comprehend truth to which others remain blind. One important thing is there that every great poet is a teacher. In this manner, Wordsworth reflects the idea of Horace than Plato's. Because Horace insisted on the principle of pleasure than just on Plato's insistence on morality or goodness. So a poet speaks to men. He has to speak in such a way as to make his thought and feelings intelligible to his readers. It becomes necessary for him to use a language free of quaint tricks. Quaint tricks means wit and cleverity. He must descend from his superior heights, where he does not belong anyway, and adopt the real language of men for his communication. The poet seeks to enlighten the readers about the universal and basic truths of human nature. So William Wordsworth makes quotes upon poet. He went to say that, fill your paper with the breathing of your heart. Next. So the poet differs from an ordinary individual, not in he is a man who has a greater and more lively sensibility, B, greater power of imagination, C, greater knowledge of human nature, D, a more comprehensive soul, so that he can sympathize and feel for others, and E, greater gist of life, and F, greater powers of communications. So these are the main features of poet in the view of Wordsworth. The poet communicates not only personally felt emotions, but also emotions which he has not directly experienced. He should try to achieve identification with his characters to make his language more lively and forceful. So the poet's imaginative power is much greater than average human beings. It enables to enlarge his scope of emotion and feeling. He can experience in his imagination. He can feel and respond to emotion which he has not directly experienced. So Wordsworth writes, every great poet is a teacher. I wish either to be considered a teacher or as nothing. Wordsworth also believed that a poet is gifted with an extraordinary strong imagination, so that he is affected by absent things as if they were present. So we see that in the view of Wordsworth, the role of teacher is very important. Wordsworth also sees the poet as a profound thinker who possesses more than usual organic sensibility. That's through the senses of his mind and other creative things. Next. So this is the last section, views on nature. Wordsworth justifies the use of meter and condemns once again the use of poetic diction. Meter is something regular and uniform, while poetic diction is arbitrary. The poet himself has used meter for a number of reasons. First, meter is an additional source of pleasure. It does not mean that meter is stricted up to the rules. It is, when it is free, it clears the meaning of poetry. B, in using meter, he has simply followed tradition. C, meter can give pleasure even without the use of poetic diction, even when the language is simple and naked. Next. D, meter has a restraining and tempering effect on the flow of emotion and passion. E, it tempers and softens the painful and the pathetic. The role of meter in his poetry to strengthen the situations happened in the poem, and its structure should be like as which delight readers. It imparts passion to the words and so increases emotional intensity. And lastly, G, the use of meter provides the element of contrast, and the perception of similarity in dissimilarity always gives pleasure. So there is a kind of extraordinary in ordinary. he also saw in nature and also in meter. However, to reduce his work to just an imitation of trees and flowers would be immature. In his view, the whole nature would be presented in a serial manner, in a story manner. Wordsworth admired nature or countryside not only because it looked beautiful, but because of the simplicity and beauty that nature or countryside it provided. It allowed people to be in touch with their soul and experience true beauty in life. Wordsworth believed that city life made the masses dull and stagnant. It had reduced them to overworked machines who failed to appreciate the simple beauty of life. So in his view, he takes chances to come with individuals, not in groups. That's all I have.